Before we look at population ecology in more detail, I want to stop for a minute and contrast two different timescales that we're looking at in these lectures. Ecology and evolution operate at very different timescales. Ecological time refers to time spans that we measured in months or years. These are just long enough for a population size to change. Evolutionary time involves time spans that are measured in generations. These are long enough for gene frequencies in the species to change. Evolutionary change takes much more time than ecological change. Okay, now I'm talking about this right now because I want you to be aware of certain evolutionary responses to typical population growth patterns. We've seen that some species are subject to high levels of density-independent population factors. They may be limited by fire and flood. But there are other species that are almost only affected by density-dependent factors. They're so close to the carrying capacity that they're limited by food, by space. And if these go on for very long periods of time, we're going to see certain evolutionary adaptations. And we'll conveniently dichotomize these into what are called R-selected species, because if you're always a long way below the carrying capacity, you're going to be able to grow at exponential growth rates. Whereas if you're up against the carrying capacity almost all the time, you can be said to be K-selected. You're always coping with high population density, limited food, limited space. So, and our selected species, we think of those as where intraspecific, or that is competition between individuals of the same species, is typically very low. They're not out there pushing each other around very much. There's tons to eat. Life is pretty great. Whereas a K-selected species that's next to that carrying capacity, it's always a question of where's the next meal going to come from? How am I going to find a place for my kid to have his own territory? How are they going to be able to survive in the next generation? So these R-selected species tend to be very small. As we've seen, they're the ones that are most subject to density-independent factors. The ones that are mostly up against that carrying capacity tend to be large population, because the only thing that knocks them back is competition with other members of their own species. You get a real difference in productivity versus efficiency between the two. R-selected species are going to grow up quickly, whereas K-selected species are trying their best to convert the limited resources that are available to them into one or two offspring at a time. Development is slow. R-selected species breed rapidly. K-selected species breed very slowly. This rhino, for example, has a gestation length well over a year, whereas these rodents have gestation lengths just under a couple of weeks. Rodents have litters. They breed like rabbits. And rhino, like primates, like people, typically only have one offspring at a time. A lot of investment in just one kid. Finally, we see that where you have this typical high rate of reproduction, high lifestyle, you have a very short lifespan. And with K-selected species, these individuals live a very, very long time. And I don't want to go into any detail on that today. We're going to have a whole lecture devoted to the evolutionary responses of this mortality versus reproduction trade-off next week. So this topic will be continued then. Meantime, all I wanted to get across now is that any persistent differences in short-term ecology have predictable effects on long-term evolution.